I'm pleased you all came tonight, so I'm going to tell you about Life at the Speed of Light. And so this is a book about the journey that we had to make the first synthetic cell. In the process of writing, is that better? Okay. In the process of writing about that journey, I decided I wanted to put it in historical context, at least for myself. And I ended up spending 2 years deciphering early history in this area, trying to define life. And the book sort of starts with Schrodinger in 1944, who gave a famous series of lectures in Dublin at Trinity College. And the reason it starts there is for two reasons. He wrote a book called What is Life, based on his lectures that stimulated a lot of scientists, including myself and Watson and Crick, to try and work out what the basis of inheritance was. Schrodinger was a physicist, and he was trying to examine, as a physicist, whether life obeyed the laws of physics as we're trying to decipher things. I had the privilege last summer of being invited to give the second Schrodinger lecture after he gave the first one, almost 70 years before. And so I used that as an occasion to try and define life based on our work. But looking back in the history, it shows it's hard to find and come up with a new idea. You think you have a new idea, and then you find somebody wrote a book about your idea in 1901. And so a Frenchman wrote a book about defining life, even though nobody knew what proteins were, nobody knew what the genetic code was, but he was sure one day, based on mechanistic principles, synthetic life would be created. In fact, he was so certain about it, he said, when somebody actually does it, it won't be the least bit surprising to anybody. Good thing I didn't read his book first, or I wouldn't have done the experiment. And even in the 1800s, 1700s, people talked about a mechanical basis or machine basis of life and predicted that synthetic life should be possible. All the history of modern biology has happened in the last 70 years. So I'm 67, so it started just a few years before my birth. When Schrodinger gave his lectures and wrote his book, people thought that protein was the basis of the inheritance material. Even though DNA was known, everybody thought it was too simple of a polymer to actually control and contain all the information necessary for inheritance. The same year that Schrodinger published his book, What is Life?, some scientists, Avery and McLeod at Rockefeller University, did the first experiment to, in fact, prove that DNA was the genetic material. But it took a long time for that to be accepted. When Watson and Crick published their famous paper in 1953 on the structure of DNA, still almost nobody paid attention to their paper. And it was only after Marshall Nuremberg and Carla discovered that there was a triplet code that coded for amino acids that people finally started to accept that DNA was the genetic material. So that's the 1960s. This is very recent history, at least if you're my age. It looks like some of you are at least that old. So I think the way things are taught, we lose sight of this history. And putting in context our definitions of life that came out of the synthetic cell work, it was important to track this early adventure in genomics. So it wasn't until the 1970s that the first genetic code was read. 1976, the first RNA genome, a small RNA virus, was decoded in Belgium. And then in 1977 is when the first DNA virus was sequenced by Fred Sanger and his colleagues that led to his Nobel Prize with the new sequencing technology that he developed. 18 years went by before we had the ability to sequence the first genome in history of a living organism. That was 1995. Things sped up from there. That was only 1.8 million letters of genetic code. 5 years later, we did the first human genome, with 3 billion letters of genetic code. So new computers, faster instruments, change substantially what could be done. In this process, when we read the genetic code and put it into the computer databases, I call that digitizing biology. And so we've been digitizing biology for some time now. We've been converting the A's, G's, and T's of the chemical DNA into the ones and zeros of the computer. And so the challenge is in understanding these ones and zeros and all this information from now the thousands to millions of species that have had their genomes decoded, including over 100 humans now. Mine was the first, but it's changing very rapidly, and with the cost of sequencing changing, very soon there'll be tens of thousands of human genomes done a year. My genome cost about $100 million to do. That's nothing. You paid for a $3 billion genome in the federal program, so mine was a bargain by comparison, because none of you had to pay for it. Unless you invested in Celera, then thank you. Today, for that same $100 million, we can do 100,000 human genomes. And that's what we need, is very large numbers to sort out why the 1% to 3% differences in all of us play such an important role, and can we predict the future? And we need large numbers to begin to do that. But the challenge has been in sorting out this data in the databases and working out the relationship between the linear DNA code, the ones and zeros in the computer, and life, whether it's human life or just trying to define it. So we decided to try and go the other direction, to start with the ones and zeros in the computer, see if we could design and build chemical DNA, and seeing if we could recapitulate life with that chemical DNA. So we started right after we finished sequencing the human genome in 2003. We started to make a small bacteriophage or a virus called PhyX174. There's only 5,000 letters in its genetic code. And it took us quite a while to develop the techniques to do this, because nobody had the ability to write long pieces of chemical DNA. They could write very short pieces, and we would take the short pieces and assemble those together almost like Lego blocks. But we had to correct all the errors and get that working. And finally, we had a procedure where we could start with the digital code in the computer, and in over 2 weeks, make the chemical DNA of this viral genome. And the exciting thing came when we then injected that into E. coli. Coli read what we call DNA software, started reading it immediately, made the viral proteins. They self-assembled to form the virus. It made millions of copies in each cell, and the virus showed its gratitude by killing the cell by bursting open and infecting a lot of other cells. So we actually call this a situation where the software builds its own hardware. Computer scientists wish they could do this. You just write computer code and it builds a new computer for you. We're not quite there yet, but we can do that now with life. Our challenge was not to make a small virus, but we were encouraged by the results. We wanted to make an entire bacterial chromosome, which was around 1.1 million letters of genetic code. It took us from 2003 to 2010 to finally achieve that. And the book describes the journey, which was anything but linear. And I think it's important, I think, for the public to understand how science actually happens. When you read about it in the press afterwards, it sounds like it was pretty simple, pretty straightforward, and you just went from one thing to another. And we had lots of dead ends, lots of problems, lots of false starts before we could actually get things working. Even in the end, when we thought we had everything put together, we went to boot up the genome, and nothing happened. And so we had to spend quite a bit going back to find out what was wrong in our design, what was wrong in our code, the same way software engineers have debugging software to find out where the errors are in the computer code. We had to find out where the errors were in the DNA code. And we found there was one letter out of 1.1 million that was wrong. And that made the difference between life and no life. That's very important in understanding how our own physiology works, because one little change can be that dramatic in the difference. So we finally got it booted up, and it worked. It was a team of 46 scientists working over almost 10 years to make this happen. And so the journey, the middle part of the book describes that long, arduous journey and the excitement of finally achieving it. But what we did in 2010 was a prototypical experiment. It proved that it was possible. The main question we would get from the press was, well, what good is this organism? The ones that were like it before, they've been living for billions of years on the planet, so it's hard to ask them what they're good for, but it didn't do anything special other than it could self-replicate and make more copies of itself, and it's done that billions of times now. And then the last part of the book is talking about the implications and the future and where this is going. And a key part of what we've been doing is this interchange between the digital and biological world. So we can interconvert the DNA code and the computer code. And so we've now gone in both directions. We digitize the genome by sequencing it, put it in the computer, and then we started with the computer code and went the other way and made chemical DNA and booted up new life from that. So from this, we developed the concept of biological teleportation that you may have heard about lately or you'll read about in the book, where we can actually send life at the speed of light, and hence the title of the book, as an electromagnetic wave, as ones and zeros, and recapitulate that life at the other end. And so we're doing two experiments now, one with NASA. We were supposed to be doing it, but the government closed down for a while and it postponed the sending unit test. So we're going out to the Mojave Desert with a fairly crude device, but it'll be taking a sample of soil, isolating the DNA from the microbes there, sequencing them, and then sending the sequence in a digital form up to the cloud. And then we're working on another instrument that we call the digital biological converter that actually takes that sequence, remakes life from it. And we have the prototype of that now working in the lab, but it's quite big. It's larger than this desk and table, so it's hardly a portable unit right now. But the value of this is we can send things like vaccines through the internet. And we're actually doing this now with BARDA and Novartis with flu vaccines. So we can actually, as soon as we get the sequence of a new flu strain, and we did this with H7N9, the outbreaks in China, the Chinese sequenced the strain, put it on the internet, and we downloaded it and remade the virus and have that as a vaccine stock. In fact, it was the only source that the CDC had for a very long time because it's easier to send digital information than it is to send infective strains through the mail or around in different ways. And so we've shortened the period for making new flu vaccines from 3 months down to about 10 hours. And so we have one of these units in North Carolina, the Novartis facility, where they just got approved for making flu vaccine for the first time using mammalian cells instead of 900 million chicken eggs, which is how we get our vaccine right now each year. So we're probably not going to be very popular with chicken egg producers, at least for the vaccine world. But we can go from the digital information to very quickly making the synthetic virus and go right into production in Novartis. And Novartis is in the process of actually scaling up in advance because we have this data well before there's significant outbreaks here. So just in case there is one, there will be a vaccine right away for it. But because we can send this information as digital information, we could send a new vaccine around the world in less than a second. And so if you had one of these digital conversion boxes, you'd be able to download the vaccine at home. We don't know how the FDA will like that. it'll change how things are regulated. But our box will also download insulin from the internet. So when you think that biology now can go and be converted from digital information back into proteins, back into viruses, back into cells, we're working on new kind of antibiotics, these same bacterial viruses like PHYX-174 that kill infectious agents in a specific fashion, which is becoming more important because more people now die from antibiotic-resistant bacteria than from car accidents in the U.S. So we're sort of moving into this pre-antibiotic area, so we can actually send an antibiotic through the internet. We don't know how many of these devices will be out there, how they'll be regulated, but the ultimate thought that I have is you would have one attached to your home computer, and if there was an outbreak of a new flu virus, you would just download the vaccine yourself. This may be easier said than done in the reality of regulation, but you know, nobody's going to know how to regulate what actually goes through the internet. They can't do it now with information, so it's going to be hard to do it with biological information. But if this becomes possible, we should never have another pandemic. These are just some of the ideas of what we're approaching and working on now. We're thinking of hiring a bunch of 11 to 13-year-olds to tell us what the real applications will be, because our thinking is probably way too staid. So maybe you know what the right piece of biology to download from the internet will be that'll make it the iPad of the future. But we've now entering this new phase of evolution where it's now controlled by humans. Social evolution has been happening orders of magnitude faster than biological evolution, but now we can move biological evolution at the same pace as social evolution, and there's obviously lots of implications for that. So why don't I stop there? I'd be happy to take your questions, and we'll go from there. Thank you very much.
I listened to you and Charlie Rose last night, and I'm glad I did, hearing things to the extent that I heard them twice. It helps with understanding. To the extent that I didn't, I just enlarged my...
Was I consistent?
Yeah, you were consistent. But one of the things that I didn't hear you say today, but I heard you say last night, was that it would be advantageous for individuals to sequence, have their own genome sequenced, their individual genome sequenced, for beyond purposes of research and so forth, to have a baseline for their own kind of purposes of their medical, strategies. The thing that I didn't understand was whether you thought that that would be a good thing, serve as a baseline. Presumably you want that at a young enough age that you catch the baseline, early enough. But on the other hand, maybe not too early. So could you elaborate on that idea? Are you willing to here?
Sure, and, a little bit. It's more the subject of my first book.
How early should we do this?
It's too late for you and me, even though mine's been done to do it too early. A decade from now, there'll be databases of hundreds of thousands of human genomes. And genetics is basically a game of statistical probabilities, something that we're not very good as a population of dealing with. People will take the risk of having a genetic deformed child with a 1 in 2 risk and at the same time go out and buy a lottery ticket where they have a 1 in 10 million chance of winning. So probabilities are something that we don't deal with well. But what we will get by having large numbers of human genomes is very accurate predictive probabilities of different disorders. In one example that I've been public with as the first one to have his genome sequenced is I'm heterozygote for the APOE4 allele associated with Alzheimer's disease. And I recently had a test, the good news was there's no amyloid in my brain. There were other things there, so that's okay. So I have close to a zero chance of getting Alzheimer's disease in the next 30 years, even though from my genetic code, I have a substantially increased risk of that. So statistics for populations have nothing to do with statistics for you and me as individuals. So you need to know your own code and your children's code to make any sense out of it, because clinical averages are close to worthless information when it comes to predicting anything about any one individual. Within the next decade, there will be these very large databases to give you much more accurate information. Hopefully we'll know why, you know, which genes I have that are different that have protected me from getting Alzheimer's disease, even though I have at-risk genes for it. And we'll get a much clearer picture about human biology. And it's the number one hope I have for lowering medical cost if we can be smart enough to deal with preventing diseases instead of treating them after they occur. The thing about getting it done early, the more important thing to get done early in life is storing stem cells, because they're going to be the most important thing for therapy in conjunction with using the ability to rewrite the genetic code with our synthetic DNA techniques doing stem cell therapy. So people that were smart enough to store their kids' cord blood in banks, it will be far more important in the future than anybody thought it was in the past. If you can get your genome done, we have a new process we're calling genome tracking, where we can actually track changes in the genome, particularly when they show up with cancer. So it's going to be around $1,000 a genome now, but we're going to be doing large numbers of them basically for free. Pretty soon, people will pay you to have your genome done to add data to the database if you have unique phenotypic data. So it's a long answer, but an important question. Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. There have been attempts to replicate the origins of life, and there's all sorts of speculation about whether the clay matrix or hydrothermal events or meteorites bringing, you know, the requisite chemicals from outer space. And I was wondering, do you have any thoughts on that subject?
I have lots of thoughts. They're probably not any more worthwhile than anybody else's thoughts. But I write about this in the book and talk about Jack Sozak's work at Harvard, where he's trying to replicate origins of life by putting RNA molecules in lipid vesicles and see if they can start to make copies of themselves. But that's very different than what we're doing. So we're building on top of 3.5 to 4 billion years of evolution by using very advanced, sophisticated species, which every species on this planet is a DNA software-driven organism. And we've shown that if you change the software, you change the species. It maybe took 3.5 to 4 billion years to get to that point, which is very different than the origins of life question, how life originated here. And maybe it started in a computer on another planet. I guess.
Since you were talking about flu viruses a little while ago, I was just wondering, is there much variation between the various varieties that we hear about? Is it like less than 1%, or is it a much higher number?
Yeah, there's two major genes in the flu virus that the mutations are of significance for tracking them. And no, in general, it's just a few letters difference. So the 1918 flu killed about 3% of the U.S. of the world's population. Some bodies were dug up that were buried in the permafrost. They still had the flu virus associated with them. And that's how the 1918 flu virus was actually sequenced. And so it didn't actually disappear. And on looking at the sequence, there were very few variations from the strains that are around today. So that's why epidemiologists and people tracking this are so concerned that it wouldn't take a huge change to get back to these very lethal forms of the flu. And the H7N9 is much closer to it than the H1N1 from a few years back. And when infectious agents are in the population, they can change rapidly. And just as a side point, it's why vaccinations are so important. Everybody thinks it's an individual choice whether to vaccinate your kids or not. It shouldn't be, unless you're going to not go out in public, because if your kids are not vaccinated and they get one of these new strains, they reintroduce it into the population and put everybody at risk. So vaccination is a community good. It should not be an individual choice unless you're going to live by yourself in the woods. It's because these organisms change very rapidly. Yes. Yes, much less than 1%.
Hi. You talked a little bit about databases. Currently, you know, there's much more sequencing going on than the databases can really handle. And you talk about with, you know, the search for more human genomes being sequenced. Do you think that the current databases are really equipped to handle it? And second question, you know, you talk about kind of molecular building and your synthesis of DNA was all at the molecular level. Do you think the next step is kind of beyond that? Like, right, you know, my impression of what you did is, you know, transferring into a host, and everything so far has been transferring into a host. When do you think we'll be able to do de novo?
Good question. So the database question, our existing databases started when it was a big deal to sequence one gene or one protein. And they keep expanding, but they were never set up in a logical fashion from the beginning. What's changing everything in the compute world and database world is cloud computing. And aside from buying most things you get from Amazon, they also have one of the biggest cloud compute infrastructures, and it becomes far cheaper to contract to Amazon for the data storage and even computes than it is to build your own computer system nowadays. So, and the cloud can expand almost infinitely, especially if there's business driving it, which it seems to be doing with Google and Amazon quite readily. So I'm not so worried about that side of things. The algorithms to compare 100,000 genomes to each other do not exist, and I think that's a much bigger challenge for the mathematicians to help us out there. I spent quite a bit in the book about this notion of life from scratch, and yes, we use a recipient cell to boot up the new chromosome. And so a lot of people thought that was cheating. I thought it was pretty clever, personally, because right now all life, as we know it on this planet, derives from other cells. And it was an early theory of cellular life that there was some early precursor cells and all life derived from those. It's an interesting academic question whether we can put enough of the enzymes to read the DNA into a lipid vesicle with an existing ribosome system and add DNA and get it booted up. It works with no cell wall, and people since the 1960s have been doing protein synthesis in cell-free systems, and in fact that's how Nuremberg discovered how the genetic code was. He actually was the first user of synthetic DNA, used synthetic pieces in an in vitro system to see which proteins were produced by changing the code. I think it would be rather simple to combine those with lipid vesicles, and a lot of people are doing that. Most of the studies that have been going on before have been misguided because it was being done by protein chemists who didn't want to recognize that DNA was important. And if you just put enzymes in a lipid bag, you'll have enzymes in a lipid bag. If you want life, you have to have an information system that drives it. So I didn't talk about that, but I go to it in depth in the book about protein turnover. And our proteins in our cells, some of them last only a few seconds. The longest ones last maybe 24 hours. If you take your DNA software out of any cell, it dies. So we're a system of continuous renewal. Every cell constantly reads the genetic code and makes new proteins and maintains the cell. And I even describe, if there's a secret to life, it's a discovery that was made by a guy named Brown in the 1800s when he looked under a microscope and saw pollen grains bouncing around. And the observation was named after him. It's called Brownian motion. And 75 years later, Einstein came up with the principles of what it was. And it's the water molecules are moving around and vibrating with their heat, and they jostle molecules around all the time. And that's basically what drives all the energy inside cells. hopefully that answers your questions. Yes, sir.
So I'm curious about the ability of society to keep up with the delivery of access to these novel technologies and the advancements in science. I work myself in commercializing products, but particularly in the orphan drug space. And, you know, we constantly face issues with governments around the world and payers. You know, when you have a very specialized product that delivers on a very targeted need, there are finite resources. So as the ability that you've talked about to deliver vast quantities of information for people to, you know, create solutions, I'm kind of curious how you would help guide us and what others might think about in this room to sort of enable that to be more of a positive experience, because it's very sad when a patient in particular or a group of stakeholders are disappointed that even though there may be a solution at hand, the ability to access it is beyond reach.
So my solution is if everybody on the planet reads my book, it will be a better place. I mean, obviously, it's a complex question, and there's no simple answer to it. I was in a panel in Boston at the book fair on Friday, and one of the young writers on the panel wrote a book about genetic engineering in animals, and she did a public opinion poll and found that less than 50% of the population understands that tomatoes have DNA. And so if that's where we start the conversation, we're in deep shit, okay? And you know, the education level is so low that trying to change things in an advanced manner takes advanced understanding. That's what books are about. That's what education's about. But we have a very low floor of education now in this country that just having better communication doesn't solve that overnight. So I think the problem is much deeper than your question even alluded to, but thank you.
Hi. Andrew Pollack had a wonderful article in the New York Times yesterday. I don't know if you had a chance to see it, dealing with synthetic biology and the development of fragrances and food additives and its impact on developing countries. And I was just curious to know, because I believe you're working on it. Do you foresee us going to the local grocery store, buying some yeast and putting it in our tank and driving off somewhere? I'm curious on how this is going to impact us.
No, I don't foresee that, but I foresee you going to the local grocery store and buying foods that have been manufactured in sterile facilities that have a much higher nutritional value and are far better for you than foods made from our current agriculture system. Cows, for example, are not a sustainable system as we go from 7 billion to 10 billion people. It takes 20,000 liters of water in a ton or so of grain to produce one steak. Obviously, you can't do that as we keep expanding what we're doing. So we're working on designing new proteins that can be made in yeast or algae.
How about as an energy source?
So there was a lot of work, including work that we're doing in our company, Synthetic Genomics, that the young man standing behind you helped start, Dave Kiernan. And we're still working with funding from Exxon and trying to improve photosynthesis in cells to make it be more efficient. You know, in this country, we've gone through now at least three cycles where there was a huge effort to try and develop bioenergy. Each time, cheap fuel has basically wiped out that effort. And this has happened again with the cracking. Producing natural gas has basically once again wiped out most of the biofuel discovery effort. So I think it again will be pushed off largely to sometime in the future to have it be really efficient, because it's almost impossible now, even though we can make biofuels, they can't compete with the cost of natural gas once again. They could compete with the cost of gasoline 10 years ago, but they can't compete today. And so when you look at making something using this technology, you make a vaccine or a pharmaceutical, something you could hold in your hand would cost about $1 million. That same thing, if you produce a fuel just to burn, is worth about 50 cents. So I think the technology in the industry is going to drive towards the higher-end products until the efficiency so increases with what we can do biologically that it can compete no matter what the gas prices are. And I see that happening sometime within the next decade, but it's not going to happen this year. Over here.
Yeah. It's such a pleasure to hear you speak. Thank you for coming. Can you please elaborate just a little bit on the technological process you envision for sending, for example, a vaccine through the internet and ultimately being able to, quote, download it at home and synthesize it at home and administer it to oneself? Is that a biological 3D printing process or something else?
Well,
Thank you.
The name is a digital biological converter or a biological teleporter, or if we're being true to science fiction history, we'd call it a replicator. And so we use all the names. You know, 3D printing is something different, but people sort of refer to this as biological 3D printing, but it's not really. Basically, we do what we did for making the first synthetic cell, only we've done this now in a single box as a single robotic device of converting the digital code back into actually writing from four to bottles of chemicals the DNA, and the DNA then gets assembled in chromosomes that can, in the case of a virus to kill bacteria, the DNA is infective on its own. In the case of downloading insulin, the DNA just serves as a template for making insulin in another little container. In the case of making cells, it's a little bit more complicated, but it's a a simplistic view. It's a DNA printer, starting with digital information, but also a robot to assemble the DNA into chromosomes and then to do something with those chromosomes.
Backing up to the antibiotic issue again, you know, you brought up the fact that it's such a problem in the society, and I keep reading recently there's been big news about all the drug companies are, you know, discontinuing their antibiotic research because of the problems here, and it seems like this is going to be part of the solution. But I was wondering if you could just give a thumbnail about how that actually works. I understand from what you described, you know, the virus and, you know, creating the virus synthetically. But what is the process on the antibiotic, just as a thumbnail sketch, if you could do that?
Basically, before penicillin, countries, particularly in Eastern Europe, were developing what is called phage technology. These are the bacterial viruses that infect a specific bacteria and kill them. So we're politics and prose. You can probably find the book Aerosmith somewhere here. Now you're dating yourselves. I describe it briefly. So Aerosmith was the first true sort of biotech novel, and it talked about one of the early proponents of genetic engineering before genetics were really known. And what they found is by using bacteriophage that they isolated from sewers, that they could cure diseases with them. In Eastern Europe, they got sort of carried away with, they would make tons of this stuff every day. And the trouble is the bacteriophage are very specific for certain bacteria. And so they tried to use them the same cocktail for everything, and it didn't work. But when they did it in a very specific fashion, it did. And also you can get resistance to them. But we're working on some that we hope will work for burn infections and things externally. But you just make the DNA. The DNA is infective in the bacteria in a very specific relationship, produces copies of itself and kills the bacteria, makes more of the phage that can infect other bacteria.
Attacks the cell wall or something?
Usually they just make so many copies, it's like an alien in a movie, and the cells burst open.
Yeah. Overwhelmed. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hi there. Thank you for your talk. I haven't read your book, so I apologize, but I did notice...
There's still time.
Yes. I did notice, I think just briefly skimming the back of the book, there was no reference to the microbiome, and I guess we're becoming now, it sounds like, the architect of our own life. Recently, Michael Pollan said that 10 out of every 11 cells is not us. It's almost as if we're a piece of coral and life is teeming and we're our own planet. And so we're a constantly evolving thing. I guess inside our gut, throughout, we're evolving. One of your researchers, Julie Dunning Hottop, was looking at Wolbachia, and this bacteria had somehow gotten its DNA into the Drosophila fly, ovaries, somehow exchanged its, a bacteria had exchanged its DNA and put it somehow into the ovaries of a Drosophila fly. So,
is there a question here?
Yeah, so the question is, so here we are designing this machine, and we're going to be designing things that, in a way, we don't yet even understand what our own microbiome is and how it affects who we are, what we're becoming. So I wondered, where are you in exploring sort of this idea that Julie Dunning, where are we to talk about at least our own sort of progression before we make this machine? We already have one.
Okay, I'll help you out there.
Yeah.
So my institute was the first one to actually do the sequencing to prove the microbiome existed. And this young lady in the back, Karen Nelson, is the president of the Venter Institute. And she did the very first paper in 2003 showing how many bacteria we all have in our guts and our skin. Right. And yes, you have roughly 10 times as many bacteria in your body as you have human cells. Not just him personally, we all do. So it's
okay. The more the better, right? The more the merrier?
Well, it depends. Most bacteria are actually good. We live on a bacterial planet. We have a paper coming out soon that'll talk about how many bacteria you're breathing in the air right now with a crowd like this. And it's only when you either have a compromised immune system or it's an unusual infective strain that emerged that it causes disease. So the microbiome is an essential part of health. Karen's published a book on it and is writing another one right now that will explain it all and answer all your questions. So
great. Where is Karen?
She's right back there. Raise your hand.
Okay. Great. Well, thank you.
Okay.
I was just wondering if you could comment on the dual use implications of a machine like a replicator. Because it's quite exciting to have the positive potential, but there's always the negative.
No, it's a very important question, and the term dual use is the modern term for any new technology that can be used for good or evil. They didn't call hammers dual use; they were multiple use. But you can hit somebody on the head with a hammer, you can build a house with it. But it refers to modern technology. Nuclear power or nuclear bombs are an example of dual-use technology. So obviously, if you can write the genetic code of any species, it is theoretically possible to reproduce infectious agents and introduce them back into the world, much the same way the 1918 flu virus was found in the permafrost. It's something that we've done lots of investigations and studies on, and one of the really good things when we announced our first synthetic cell in 2000, President Obama asked his then newly formed Bioethics Commission to take this on as their number one issue. And I would urge any of you that are interested, you can download this report from the White House website on synthetic biology, and I think they did a superb job weighing out the positive benefits, the risk, and various ways to mitigate the risk. With the instruments that we're designing, we're trying to design very advanced security into the machines, so in theory they can't be hacked and used for some other purpose, and we're working with some government agencies to check them out and give us the latest technology. We'll only sell them to certified users, and we can verify through the internet whether you're that user or not, and we can shut off the machine if you're not the right user, and also even getting the bottles of chemicals to put it, the cartridges to put in the machine will be under very tight control. That becomes harder if everybody has one on their home computer, but right now antiviral software is really key for your computer. It would be even more important if you can download biology. So these are serious issues. A lot of people are spending a lot of time on them, but you can spread disease and viruses almost as fast through the airline industry as you can through the computer web. So it's equally important to solve either way. And one of the earlier questions was about the pharmaceutical industry and antibiotic development. And yes, a lot of pharmaceutical companies are abandoning developing new antimicrobials because they can make a lot more money off of treating chronic diseases like diabetes. And the thought was, part of the problem we have is the pharmaceutical industry tried to get a single antibiotic that would work against everything. And that made them a lot of money for a while, but it made the bugs resistant to these very broadly used antibiotics. So there's a smaller market for the one just to kill that type of staph or strep. And it gets down to economics. So when it's a problem of economics, that's where there's a role for the government to do things that industry won't do on its own, because it's the same issue for dual use. If the threat is a new biological agent, a far bigger threat is new emerging infections, and that's a bigger threat to all of us. Either way, we need new antibiotics and new antivirals. If we have those, there's no biological threat either way. You finally get another question.
Okay. Speaking of dual use, about 100 years ago, the English mathematician Hardy mentioned that he was proud that the math he was doing had no practical use. Well, some of the work he was doing was with prime numbers. And anyone who's familiar with encoding using very large prime numbers knows that there's a real practical use for such things. But actually, my question is, back to your replicator or converter, how simple or complicated are the feedstocks besides water?
They're no more complicated than the ink in your home printer. They're just different. You know, the four bases of DNA, A, C, G, and T, and they're not immensely complex. They're small molecules. Yes, ma'am.
I have maybe three questions, at least two. The first one is when you
ask
look
them
at
one at a time, because I can't remember three questions.
I'm going to try to remember mine too. The first one has to do with the difference between the genome by itself and the genes that are expressed in a cell. How do you differentiate between that when you target a particular medicine for it, and how do you think the genome should be sequenced in terms of how it is expressed?
So the gene expression is different in every type of organism. Right. In these very simple mycoplasma bacteria, basically it's binary. Either they're all turned on or they're turned off. As you get into more complicated cells, things are under more specialized regulation. But the technique that I developed in the late 80s and early 90s, it actually characterized the expressed genes in the genome. It was called express sequence tags, and that's how we discovered most genes. So it's very easy now to measure what's turned on in a cell and what's not.
Second question is that if you look at the synthetic cells, I assume these cells replicate. How do you control the evolution of those cells?
So part of the definition that we're using for life is it's a self-replicating organism. That's not necessarily true. You're not currently self-replicating, but a lot of your cells are. You just can't see that going on. So you can build in rapid or slow evolution into the design of the organism. And if we were to do a swab on everybody's lungs here, everybody has a different strain of Haemophilus influenza in your lungs. And it's because there's basically a very simple tetramer repeat in front of all the genes that code for surface antigens. And what happens, it's literally the DNA polymerase trips on these repeats and puts in changes in the gene downstream. Sometimes it knocks out the gene, sometimes it changes it. But in all of our lungs, our cells, our bacterial cells, are evolving on a second-to-second basis to constantly avoid our immune system. So in fact, when we worked with Reno Rapalje and Novartis to make the first meningitis B vaccine that just came out on the market this year, we picked genes that were not subject to that kind of evolution. And so the vaccine worked against all meningitis B strains. If we want cells that we're designing to evolve rapidly, we put in a lot of these kinds of repeats, so they'll do that. If we want them to not evolve very rapidly, which if it's going to be a manufacturing organism, you want it to be stable, you can change that. So we've gone a long way in the last 40 years to understand what the code tells us, and the early phases of genome design give us a lot of control.
And the third question I have would be, if you is one environmentally an environmental application, do you see synthetic biology as being used to generate cells that would help clean up the planet?
In many ways, yes, but I think we're all very resistant to put new synthetic life forms into the environment to do that. That would be very much a last-ditch effort for the planet. We may need to get there at the rate we're going, but for example, you can use synthetic modified algae to capture the CO2 from a power plant and cycle that back into a carbon fuel that can be reburned. But that's in a specialized chamber. We wouldn't want to put those in the ocean right now. And in fact, one of the things I didn't mention, but it's covered extensively in the book, is we insist that with anything we make, we watermark the DNA so we know that it's a synthetic organism. And we did this very elaborately. We devised a code. You can write the entire English language with numbers and punctuation in the DNA code and specify exactly what it was and where it was made, because that becomes very important to distinguish synthetic life and the synthetic tree from naturally occurring evolution. And because the two branches now are going to separate quite dramatically, we want to keep track of that. Is that it for questions?
Just wondering, I haven't heard anyone talk about epigenetics tonight, and I was just wondering if you could address that field in your how that affects your work.
So the question was, nobody asked anything about epigenetics. So it's an interesting question that I get quite frequently, because it's a problem with how we divide science in universities and government institutions, where people will study one piece of things and they sort of don't do it in the context of everything else. So epigenetics are all the things that happen inside the cell after the DNA codes for the protein and the proteins exist and they do other things. But I want to make a t-shirt to make people in this field wear that says epigenetics is still genetics, because everything in the epigenetic world derived originally from the genetic code. But regulation, as I said earlier, in each cell type, it plays a different kind of role. But the regulation of breaking down the proteins in the cell is an essential part of life. And I describe in the book, there's multiple diseases, including Alzheimer's disease, that if you don't traffic out the garbage that's created from breaking down these proteins, accumulates and causes disease. So regulation, as we move into eukaryotic cells and more advanced cell types, is going to be much more important. And it's going to be harder to build into the design of the genome. Most of this design right now is empirical design. And the test is survival and the biology that you're looking for. So one of the exciting things, and I describe it, there's a contest, an iGEM contest, that high school and college students participate in now around the world. It's really amazing, where they design little circuits out of biology, the equivalent of electronic circuits, gates, switches, oscillators. And so the future genome designers will have these new tool sets that totally changes how we look at biology in a straight mechanistic format that utilizes what's evolved, but changes it very rapidly into a new era. Thank you.